my, that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quick refilled.
Our fans.
Wow.
The box is now Sinclair going to watch it get put into the back of the semi-trailers. And see those go out. It's a very cool thing. So we'll take part in that. Let's open up this morning in a word of prayer. And let's begin, continue our worship. Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity we have to be here. I thank you for this church, for the people that are here, the love, the friendship that we have. God, I ask that you would just help us to guard that very, very closely. Help us to love each other, Lord. Help us to, more importantly, love you. And our actions today, our thoughts, our words, our singing, our speaking, everything that we do, bring honor and glory to you this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's stand and worship. We sang the song last year about this time. We're thinking about thanks to the Lord. My heart is filled.
My heart is filled with thankfulness to hear you, Lord.
Oh,
face today.
Thank you. Eternal salvation of people because hell is real.
This isn't a figment of someone's imagination. We'll get more to that in the next week. But let's start with some basic groundwork on what hell is. And to do that, we're going to learn, are you ready, some Hebrew and Greek today. Which is really sad because I'm not very good at Hebrew and Greek. As you know, I'm not very good at English. So we'll see how this goes. Let's take a look at a couple of the words that are translated into hell in the Bible. Let's start with the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the most common word for hell is the word Sheol. This is used in multiple places, and it has a couple of different meanings or emphasis depending on what passage you're looking at. We're going to go through a couple of these examples very quickly. The first use is the grave. When you see the word Sheol sometimes in the Bible, in the Old Testament, it is referring to the grave. Go back in your mind to Genesis 37, Joseph. We talked about Joseph during our stewardship series. Joseph was so loved by his brothers that they tried to kill him, and ultimately they just sold him off to some slave traders. And if you remember, the brothers went home to dear old dad and gave him the bad news. No, he didn't tell them that he sold your favorite son. They said, "Dad, Joseph was killed by a wild animal." And I'm sure they all acted sad. You know, they had to put on a show. The reality is they sold him into slavery. And Jacob is just so devastated by this loss. In Genesis 37, 35, it says, "All his sons, all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, 'No, I shall go down to Sheol to my son, mourning.'" In other words, Jacob says, "Listen, I'm going to go to my grave, mourning the loss of this son, my favorite son." So we see a picture of the grave. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, David has written a kind of a psalm, and he is just thanking God. He was in a situation where he was almost killed. And he says this in verse 6 of chapter 22. He said, "The cords of Sheol," or the grave, "entangled me. The snares of death confronted me." How many of you like zombie movies? Come on, be honest. All right, a couple of you are. Sees this. Think about those old campy zombie movies, right? Someone's walking, and what happens? That hand pops out of the ground, grabs the ankle. Some of you are just shaking your head. I've lost all respect. And that's okay. David's saying, "Listen, the grave was like grabbing at my ankle. It was trying to pull me down. It was going to kill me, but God stepped in and saved me from shame, the grave." In Job chapter 14, Job was going through a lot of trials, a lot of physical suffering, a lot of physical loss. And he gets to the point where he basically says this in 14:13. He says, "Oh, that you would hide me in Sheol, or the grave, that you would conceal me until your wrath be past, that you would appoint me a set time and remember me." In other words, Job is saying, "God, just let me die. I don't want to keep going through these things. I'm not strong enough. I'm not capable. Just put me in the ground. And then come back to me when this is over, and we'll go through the judgment, we'll go through those things. But I can't do this. Give me the grave." That's kind of a very low point in life right there. Sometimes the word Sheol is referring to just simply a pit, but not just, you know, a pothole. I don't want you to walk around town like, "Oh, look, there's a Sheol in my driveway or my street." There's a special kind of use for this. It's not just a hole, it is a pit. And let me explain in Numbers. Chapter 16, we have a man named Korah. Korah is of the tribe of Levi, but he's not a priest. He has no power, he has no authority, he has no position, but he wants it. Korah's a proud man. And he kind of looks at Moses and he says, "Moses, you got too much power, I want some of that." And he starts a rebellion. He gets some people to follow with him. And he goes up and confronts Moses and says, "Hey, let's do some changes here. I will be in control." They go back and forth. And in Numbers chapter 16, let me just read a couple of verses so you get the idea of what happens. God determines who's in control very clearly. In Numbers chapter 16, in verse 31, "As soon as he had finished speaking all these words, the ground under them split apart. The earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up with their households and all the people around the Korah and all their goods. So they and all that belonged to them went down alive into Sheol, and the earth closed over them, and they perished from the midst of the assembly. Wow. That's really big. These people were rebelling against God's appointed and anointed leader. And they were so far gone that the earth, God caused the earth to just open up, swallow them, and it says that it went down to Sheol. It was a pit. But that word Sheol also references what we've talked about as Hades. The Jewish belief was that when a person died, good or bad, follower of Jehovah God or not, you went to a place called Hades. And that's where you waited for judgment. Job chapter 26, verses 5 and 6 says, the dead tremble under the waters, and their inhabitants, and Sheol is naked before God, and Abaddon, or destruction, has no covering. Every soul, good or bad, righteous or unrighteous, in the Jewish thought, went to Sheol. Those who rejected God went to a place of torment, and those who followed Jehovah God went to a place called Abraham's bosom or paradise. And hopefully those statements sound a little bit familiar from last week. And we've talked about those. That brings us into the New Testament. I want you to take your Bibles. I want you to go to Luke chapter 16. In your pew Bible, it's on page 533. Matthew, Mark, and then Luke, and John. We looked at this passage last week. This is the passage regarding Jesus' teaching, and he uses a man named Lazarus, and a very rich man. He contrasts these two individuals. And you remember what happened. The rich man had everything in life. He had the parties, he had the house, he had the servants, he had everything that we look at as success. And then he had at the opposite end of the spectrum, a man named Lazarus, poor beggar. Couldn't afford food, couldn't afford a place, couldn't afford health care, couldn't afford any of the things that we need to survive. So he just sat outside the gate and begged. I want you to jump in with me in the middle of this passage in Luke 16, verse 22, the point where both men died. Verse 22, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and sent Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame. Verse 25, Abraham said, child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, you are in anguish. And beside all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who could pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. Again, Christ is describing Sheol. Now, in the Greek, it is the word Hades. Those two are equivalent words. We see two separate compartments. We have the rich man who died without Christ in this place of torment, and we have Lazarus in this place of paradise. And between them is a great chasm. So there's no going back and forth. You know, you can't go for a holiday to paradise and then go back to the torment. It just doesn't work. This is a place of torment. Notice that there was some anguish mentioned. The rich man begged Abraham, let Lazarus just come over with just the littlest drop of water. Any little relief or the split second would be great. And Abraham said, no, you cannot go from one to the other. Now I want to make sure we're not confused on something, because last week, I said when a believer dies, they immediately go to heaven. Remember that? But here we just said that this believing beggar went to Hades, to that place of paradise. Let me explain what happens. Before Christ died on the cross, if you believed in Jehovah God and you trusted that someday he would provide the atonement or the covering for your sins, you would go to that place of paradise, in Hades. You couldn't be in God's presence because because you still had sin. That sin had not been paid for yet. You were looking for it. You were anticipating the day when it would. Christ came. He died on the cross. And you remember what he said to the thief? Today, you will be with me in paradise. Christ is still alive. He hasn't paid the price. But when he died, his blood was shed. He paid the penalty for our sins. Now, the spirit of the person who is a believer can stand in God's presence because they are clean. We are sinners through and through. I don't think anybody would argue that point too much with it. But because of Christ's work on the cross, God looks at us who have accepted Christ as our Savior, and he says, I don't see your sin, I see my Son. And his righteousness, and that covers us. And so now, after the cross, we are able to be in the presence of God in our spirit and our soul. Before the cross, they put it. At this point in time, when a believer dies, they do not go to the Hades. They go to the place to heaven. Now, there's a whole lot of deeper theological debates we can get into, but I'm not prepared for that today. But just that's why it sounds like there might be a contradiction. When there's not. Christ's death, his blood, makes the difference in the way we go. Now there's two other Greek words besides Hades that are used in the New Testament to refer to hell. The first one is Tartarus. And here's another one that can cause a ton of debates, and we're going to avoid it. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4 says this. If God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell, or the Greek word Tartarus, committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment. Understand the mind of the group. Again, we believe in Hades here, and when the person dies, Tartarus was like the absolute lowest level of hell that you could possibly be sent to. Now here's the problem. There's a lot of misunderstanding or misconceptions about hell. You were to read Dante's Inferno or look at some of the Greek mythology. You've got all of these different things in play and people kind of coming and going, and Hades as a person and all of these things that are not biblical. If you watch some of today's Hollywood blockbusters, I'm pretty confident you're probably not getting good biblical lessons. So there's a lot of misunderstandings. But in the Greek mind, Tartarus was the absolute worst place. And the person goes, you read this verse, it says God did not spare the angels when they sinned, and he cast them down into hell, and he bound them up. Are angels bound today? Demons bound today? No. They're everywhere. They're causing problems. This verse is looking forward to the day. It won't take the time, but we can look in Revelation that there's going to be the battle, and God is going to defeat Satan. And the angels then and Satan are going to be literally bound and thrown into Hades, into hell. And that's what this verse is looking forward to. This is the only use of this word in all of the New Testament. The third word for hell is the word Gehenna. I want you to turn to Mark chapter 9. You're there, Luke. Go to the left just a little bit. Mark chapter 9, page 534. In the Pew Bibles. And let me give you some background on this word as you turn. Gehenna references a place just outside of Jerusalem. During the time of Isaiah, there was a couple of kings who set up a grove to worship this god called Moloch. And we talked a little bit about Moloch during our study of Judges this year. One of the ways Moloch was worshipped was through child sacrifice. There are various ways that they would do it. We won't get into the details, but basically they burned the children. They killed them and they fell into the fire. It was just not a good thing. And God brought some judgment on that. But eventually a new king came who looked at God and said, no, God is right, Jehovah's right. This stuff going on outside the city in the valley of Hinnom is wrong. And so what he did is he desecrated that holy space. He turned it into a garbage dump. And so all the refuse from the city and all the sewage and all of the yuck was taken and thrown and disposed of in the valley of Hinnom, Gehenna. And in order to get rid of it, they burned. They pretty much just kept a fire going constantly here in this valley. Now, Christ uses this word for hell, Gehenna, multiple times. We're going to look at Mark chapter 9. Let's begin in verse 43. And Christ here is talking about temptation. Temptation to sin. And he uses Gehenna to really kind of hammer home his point. Look at this. Mark chapter 9, begin verse 43. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed rather than having two hands to go to hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched. Look at verse 45. If your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame rather than having two feet and cast into hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched. Verse 47. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of heaven with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire or Gehenna. We think about this garbage dump that's just constantly on fire, and you know what you have in garbage dumps, right? Maggots and rodents and just all sorts of nastiness. Christ is using this picture of Gehenna, this garbage dump that's perpetually on fire. It's constantly just nasty. And he says, listen, it would be better for you to go into heaven missing some part of your body than to be whole and go to hell. Now realize, Christ is not saying that we need to get the knives out and start lopping off body parts. If we had a person who was struggling with viewing pornography, we're not going to take their eyes out, because the reality is we don't need to see it to have an issue with us. Pulling our eyes out is not going to solve the problem. If we have a person who's got a drug addiction, we're not going to lop their hand off so they can put the needle in their arm or lift the alcohol to their lips. We're just not going to do it. It doesn't make sense. Christ is using exaggeration to get a point across. It is so much worse in hell than in heaven. And it would be better for you to go to heaven incomplete with injuries than it would be to go to hell whole. It's quite a statement. Christ is making it very clear. Hellfire is not a pleasant place to be. He ends that passage, verse 48, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. Hell doesn't sound like a prediction. I don't plan on taking a family vacation and going to a garbage dump to see how it works. I don't think my kids would go with me even if I did. We don't want to think about these things. And that's the picture that Christ is giving, not just here in Mark, but in Matthew, in multiple places. Multiple places we see that. Now let's shift our focus a little bit. That's kind of a background or foundation on hell. But there's some questions that I'm sure we all have. And today and the next week, we're going to answer some of these questions. The first one I want to talk about is, why does hell even exist? If God is such a loving God, if God is such a caring, gracious, merciful God, why in the world would there even be a hell? Well, let's talk about that. First of all, hell is a punishment for those rejecting God. Think about the very first beings who rejected God. That would be Satan, right? Satan stood there in heaven. He said, someday I will be greater than the Most High. I will be the one in charge. I will receive all the glory. It's all about me. He rebelled against God, and he brought many of the angels with him. Look at this verse in Matthew 25. Then he will say to those on his left, this is Christ speaking, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Hell was created to house the angels, the demons who rebelled against him, and Satan, the ringleader. Hell is a punishment for rejecting God. But it's not just the angels that have a place in hell. You know, there are many humans in all of history that have rejected Christ, will reject Christ. We looked at this passage in Revelation chapter 20 last week. Remember the great white throne judgment. They're standing before the very throne of Christ himself. Christ presents two books, two sets of books. The first is that books of works. And the whole point of those books is to show that an individual cannot earn their way to heaven. Remember Romans 3:23, we have all sinned, we all fall short of God's standard, his expectation of holiness. When a person says, I don't need Jesus, I can get to heaven on my own, that's a rejection. That's rebellion. And so God says, fine, you want to try this? Let's keep trying. So he stands before Christ at this judgment. As he looks through the books, he sees that none of his works were enough to earn him salvation. But there's one other book, the book of life. And that book is open, and if that person's name, that book is a record of everyone who have accepted Christ. If your name is in that book, the works, it don't matter. It's that book, the Lamb's Book of Life. You want your name in there. And if it's in there, you're saved. You go to the new heaven and the new earth. But those whose name are not found, verse 15 of Revelation 20, the name's not found in the Book of Life, you're thrown into the lake of fire. Hell was created for a purpose. This is not a God who said, oh, you're going to ignore me? Well, here's what I'm going to stick you with. It's not the attitude that happened. We kind of hear that attitude. How can I worship a God who would send me to hell? How can I follow a God who creates such a place? And we're going to continue to walk through that. But listen, everyone has the opportunity to be right with God. Christ died on the cross so that all could be saved. God so loved the world that whosoever believes will not perish. Every individual has a choice. Every person makes that choice to either accept Christ or to reject it. Hell is created for those who choose to reject it. Next question. What will hell be like? You guys remember Tom and Jerry? The cartoon, the cat and mouse. You know the whole cat thing? How many of you remember the Tom and Jerry cartoon where Tom dies and he keeps going down the elevator, that, you know, and then what is it? It's a big pot and, you know, pitchforks. Yeah. Again, Tom and Jerry, not a great source for good sound theology. Just go down. Let's talk about what hell is going to be like. First, we know that there's fire. We've mentioned that. We saw that in Mark 9, where we are right now. We saw that in Luke 16, where the rich man was in anguish because of the flames. Fire is connected with hell frequently. Look at this verse here, Revelation chapter 21, verse 8. It says this, as for the cowardly, the faithless, and the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Fire is very strongly connected. Now remember, fire is often used as a picture of God's judgment. And so we have fire now. We also have darkness. Matthew 25:30. That is the passage we looked at with the talents. Remember, we had three servants. All of them were given wealth. All of them were given money. And the whole job that they had to do was to take that money and make more money. The first two servants went out and they doubled their wealth. And they brought it back to the master and said, listen, we did what you want us to do. Here's your money, plus here's more. Remember what the master said? Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in a few. You will now be given more. You're rewarded. We get servant number three. He approaches his master with the exact amount that he was given to invest. And he lays it before the master's feet. And he says, listen, I was afraid of failure. I was afraid I was going to lose it all. And I know that you're a harsh man and I don't want to disappoint you. So here is the money that you have. It's dirty because I buried it. The master was upset because that was not the standard. That was not the expectation that he had. And you get down to verse 30, and the servant is told this, cast the worthless service into the outer darkness. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So the entire chapter of Matthew 25 is focused on that final judgment. Two servants receive the reward, but one here was punished. Darkness. I don't like darkness. My indoor soccer team is practicing down at Mission Meadows. And last Monday night, we finished up practice, and they didn't have any of the lights on out in the parking lot. And it was just a little bit scary because they have these steps that go up, but there's a block of wood that you step on and then a drop off where the gravel is. I'm glad it was dark because I think I was on my hands and knees crawling. Can you imagine being in a place that is just completely dark? How lonely that is, how scary that is. See that last phrase, weeping and gnashing of teeth? That brings us to the sorrow. That phrase, weeping, gnashing teeth, is used multiple times by Christ. He is emphasizing the sorrow that we're going to find in hell. We're going to have sorrow. Those who are there are going to have sorrow because they realize, you know what? They have missed out on the opportunity to have that relationship with God that they so desperately need. They're going to remember, they're going to know all of the opportunities, I believe, that they had to make a decision for Christ and they chose not to. They're going to remember the times they put themselves above God. And they're going to realize that there's no more chances. They're going to be weeping. They're going to be grinding their teeth. They're going to be struggling with this punishment, this great sorrow. One last characteristic of hell that we see is separation from God. And remember Luke 16, the rich man wanted that, just that little drop of water, and Abraham said, no, I can't. There's this barrier between us. There's a chasm. We cannot go from here, and you cannot come here either. There's another verse, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. It says this, they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord. When you're in hell, you are separated from God. Now, if you remember some of your basic theology, we have a word, God is omnipresent, which means he is everywhere. See, God is not restricted to our limits. God is not in our dimension. He is above that. And so God is everywhere. We look through the Psalms, we look through a lot of different passages that tell us God is everywhere. But here in hell, we are separated from God. That opportunity to have the relationship with God, it's set. It is cut. It's just not possible to have that opportunity again. When you think of all of these descriptions, and there's some others that we aren't getting into this morning. I don't like fire. I get burned by crying like a baby. Not real big on darkness, although I've outgrown the nightlight. I'm pretty proud to say that. Sorrow, yeah, I don't dwell with that either. But separation from God, that's major. That is major because God is the one person, the one being that I need more than anything else. Your relationship with God is the crucial point of our entire life. Take your Bibles and go to Ephesians. There in Mark, go to the right to the book of Ephesians, page 617, Ephesians chapter 2. While you're turning, listen to some of these other verses. Isaiah 59:2 says that our sins have separated us. The relationship we need with God is severed. Hebrews 9:27 says it's appointed man wants to die and then have that the judgment. That relationship is gone. So the most important thing that we can do in this life is to make sure that our relationship with God is secure. And in Ephesians chapter 2, we see not just the why, with the how. That we can have this relationship. Look at Ephesians 2:4. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses or our sins, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Verse 7. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace we have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Just catch the why and the how of the relationship with God in that passage. In order for us to have a personal relationship with God, we have to understand this. Why do we get this opportunity? Is it because of how good we are? How hardworking we are? How good-looking we might be? Thankfully, no. It is none of those things. Ephesians 2:4 says very clearly, God being rich in mercy. And because of the great love that he has for us. That's why we get the opportunity. You know what? The reality is, when we sin, there is nothing that stops God from just saying, out, you're done. There's no reason for him to keep us around. But because of his great love, and his great mercy and his grace, we have the opportunity to have this relationship with him. I can't explain the why other than to say God. God loves us. I'm thankful for that. But how? How do we get this relationship? Well, verse 8, for by grace you are saved through faith. This is your own doing, this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Think about a gift. A couple of weeks ago, you guys gave me and my family some very wonderful gifts for being your pastor. The reality is, you know, you didn't have to do that. You chose to do that as an expression of your love for my family and for myself. And when those things, you know, when Roger came up and he handed me that thing, I had a choice to make, didn't I? I could have said, oh, yeah, no thanks. I'm just going to do it on my own. Of course, I knew there was bacon. I could have chosen to say, you know what, I appreciate the thought, love the effort, but I'm going to just say no. I'm not going to take this free gift that you're giving me. How would you have felt? That would be pretty offensive, wouldn't it? Paul says here, listen, salvation, the relationship with God, it is a gift. You didn't earn it. You don't deserve it. But I want to give it to you so that you have the chance to go to heaven and not to hell. I wonder today how many have looked at God as he presents this gift to us and says, no, thank you. I'm a pretty good person. I think I can make this on my own. You know what? I don't believe in God. I don't need him. I'm a self-made man. You would never think of turning down a gift. And yet so many times, people today reject God. And as we've seen today, and as we're going to see a little bit more next week, hell is real. There's no middle ground. There's no wiggle room. Hell exists. And for those who have chosen to reject God in this life, in a sense, they get what they want in the next. I don't like to think about these things. But the reality is there is probably someone here today who needs to be reminded that God is standing here offering you the free gift of life. Simply place your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. What are you going to do with that gift of grace? If you have haven't accepted him yet, it's not too late. You're still here. You're still alive. You have the chance to renew that relationship with Jesus. So that when you stand before God and he opens up the books of works, he says, Dan, I'm sorry. Not going to cut it. Oh, but your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And because of that, well done, my good and faithful servant, enter into the presence of the Lord. Don't put off receiving this gift any longer. Don't walk out that door today without talking to me or someone who can help you understand what it means to follow Christ. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, I struggle to understand the concepts and realities of hell. Yeah, Lord, I know that you have made a way for each and every person to avoid it, to not have to be destined for hell through Jesus Christ, your Son. God, I thank you for the fact that it's not anything that we do. We don't earn our salvation. We don't have to go through the checklist of things. We just simply have to follow you and trust you. Place our faith in you. Believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who needs to make that decision, please give them the courage that it takes to speak. Speak with someone so they can know you. God, thank you so much for the grace that far exceeds our sin. Thank you for your love for us. Lord, I pray that we will accept it. In your name we pray. Amen. As we close this morning, I ask you.